with BPD ghost someone if a fear of abandonment is strong with them? Oh, okay. Well, actually, that's the very reason. They will ghost you because they need to abandon you because they are just darn sure you're going to abandon them. And that may have absolutely nothing to do. It usually has absolutely nothing to do with reality. Would have nothing to do with where you were, Jack, or what you were going to do or not do. But they perceive this again because they do, people with BPD who don't have enough treatment yet to know this yet, they are subconsciously, like, they don't know this, but their perception of abandonment and the fear that you're going to abandon them, they then look at you as, like, I've said this a lot, but I don't mind saying it again, it's really important. They are relating to you from a dissociated place as if you are the, you know, object other representation of parent, whichever parent, bad parent, good parent, into valuation, bad parent. So in other words, parent that hurt me so bad, person with BPD might say, that I don't trust you, their issues, right? They've never really learned trust. How can they without knowing themselves? And they will just, there's no rational reason often or anybody threatening to leave or anything. But when they get to that place of like too close or it feels too good, it's all unsafe, it triggers the repetition compulsion and they're going to abandon you before you can abandon them. And then when you say, why would they do this when their abandonment fear is so strong? Well, they usually have somebody else lined up. Not that they always cheat, but they're going to go to the next person really quickly and smack together with them because for that reason. But they also, after they abandon you, they believe that it was you that abandoned them. So it's kind of complicated. But and then you said, Jack said, my girlfriend was so scared of me leaving her, then she was the one to end it. Well, and that's exactly why. Like, I was just giving you that response. That's exactly why she left when she left, because she was so scared you would leave, which wasn't based on you. I want you to know that. You know, not necessarily at all did you do a darn thing to make her fear that even more. That just comes with the territory of BPD because they haven't got a sense of self. They have never been able to build trust for self or for anybody else. And try as they might, this is a reason why a lot of them just leave, discard, abandon first, even though I'm sure, Jack, you weren't going to abandon her, and partners aren't sitting there thinking they're going to abandon them any minute. So it's but yeah, it's just because of how scared she got. So she wanted to make sure she left. That way, I guess in a sense, they kind of blame you for abandoning them, but they feel like it's kind of weird. They just feel, basically, so they don't get surprised. I'll add that in there too, because if they make the choice and they do it, then they know when it's going to happen. Whereas this fear builds if they try to stay in a relationship because without therapy and treatment, because it just builds and builds and builds and builds, and they have more and more anxiety. And so, there's a sort of pseudo feeling of strength, and they need to, they feel it's important, like they can be triggered if they're surprised, and they feel more in control if they actually abandon before you do. The Hill, wow, thanks for explaining this. It makes my situation make sense. Well, I'm glad, because I know that one of my jobs in life, and I mean this seriously, I'm not being facetious, is since I was blessed enough to recover from BPD and worked hard enough for that, that I can explain it from the inside out too. And that, so what I'm doing there, I guess, I can explain it in a way that helps people like you, and I hope Jack and others, to understand it, because I'm explaining the part that makes no sense to anybody who hasn't been through it. You know what I'm saying? That's what I mean. I'm not getting full of myself here. I mean, in some ways, sometimes I think to myself, oh, so I kind of like, quote, I'm a air quote expert on BPD. It's like, that's not what I thought, but you know, it's okay. I've worked it through. But if it's helpful, that's the main thing. I really want to help people who have no reference. You're lucky, right? You have no reference to understand how to make sense out of what doesn't have any sense in it. So that's what I hope to help with. So, Michelle, yes, I had to shut it down today. Therapist was asking about my so-called mother. And it triggered bad. AJ, sadly, I couldn't do it. Talk about it. I tried. Well, hey, Michelle, you tried. And then you said it was so painful. Yes, and it will be painful, but you know, you tried. And so the key thing is to just keep on trying, you know, and maybe talk to your therapist about, you know, more grounding techniques, more ways to feel safe, ways to soothe yourself, because that's really important. And I must say, in my recovery journey, I think they were sort of helping me with that, but I think I went head first plummeting into a lot of the harder work and the pain, and then had to figure out how to cope. And they were there to help me, but it's better if you have sort of a container of safety and grounding, some self-soothing skills, mindfulness techniques, relaxation techniques to be able to go there, because it's not only painful, like you said, Michelle, it's extremely painful, it's also very scary, you know, and maybe for the reasons in what I was explaining earlier. But you might not want to think too much about that, but maybe if you can remind yourself, Michelle, that anything and everything that happened with your so-called mother, you've already survived it. So when it gets really scary, to know that with deep breathing and different kind of techniques, you definitely can do this and get through this. But, you know, you have to go at your own pace, too. And you have to build trust with the therapist. And they should never be sort of pushing you, or you have to be ready, but you have to just keep trying until you make that first breakthrough. And then the first breakthrough will lead to the next breakthrough. And it's so difficult. I mean, if I were to describe what I went through, I don't even know how to describe it anymore. It was incredibly painful. But I think the other comment I was going to make when I was explaining the pain was, and it all gets externalized, you know, by the time of the arrested emotional development, actually in infancy, if there's really like no connection, no healthy bonding. I didn't have any bonding, no bond with my mother, not even a trauma bond. And what happens is then everything gets externalized, because like I said in my one whiteboard, little mini whiteboard video there, when this child part is split off from through trauma, what happens is, like Bradshaw said, if it's anger, and there is primal rage to these unmet needs, I mean, God, it's a psychological death. There's going to be rage mounted there, because the whole infant or toddler feels like they're going to die, but doesn't have any, like, there's no verbal words for that. There's no, like, thoughts for that. The body just feels it. And so, and then like Bradshaw said, we put that aside. We put anger, any negative feelings an infant will put to the side. So then people with BPD are faced with, I know I always had this conceptualization that my pain was this big black cloud over my head or something that was going to chew me up and eat me whole and kill me. And one of the biggest first steps in this, like I'd had lots of therapy, but when I got to the group therapies where I recovered, one of the hugest things they taught me, and it was over a course of time, I'm not exactly sure how I learned it, but to bring that out, their pain is going to kill me, realize it was inside, and that it wasn't going to kill me, right? So that was huge. But just keep working on it, Michelle. Don't expect too much from yourself too fast, and don't, I mean, I know it's been a while, and it seems like, you know, you want it like yesterday, but just take it a step at a time and a try at a time, you know, because when you get that triggered, hopefully your therapist was able to help you, and it really is, it can't be a fast process, unfortunately. So that's what really kind of sucks about it, too. Some parts of healing can speed up after, but getting to the core wound and dealing with that separation individuation is very, very crucial and hard to get to. Once you get there and once you start it to get in there and realize you can do it and you're building coping skills, after that work, a lot of things can speed up in therapy for people. So, but yeah, so anyway, it's BPD, trauma-based response in so many ways. And even for those in the 25% with perceived abandonment versus actual, that still feels traumatizing to them, even in the 25% or when it isn't mom's fault, you know, so. Yeah, let's just leave it at that, I think, for that. But, There's something else I was going to say, but I don't know what it was. Oh, the hill. Yes, my person explains it as a perpetual cloud over their head. Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, because I didn't think I was alone with that in the past. I think she doesn't realize the core issue, maybe because it's too painful and hard. Well, definitely. And I mean, when I was like a kid and when I was in my teens and when I was in my early 20s, that would describe me too. And I probably could and probably did verbalize, I feel like there's a cloud over my head or I'm doomed or whatever. And but I wasn't aware, and I didn't even know how much pain was inside of me. Like, I didn't even know what had happened to me, if in fact that's what happened to me. That's why I'm still working on this BPD versus response to trauma versus pathologizing the personality, separating the person from the behavior, which is all something that we look at from a clinical perspective, which people in their lives being traumatized and hurt, they don't expect people to have the same view in that regard. Michelle, nearly 48. Geez, AJ, I'm getting older. Yes, I now know I had a child. Still unhealed, still in victim mode. That is heartbreaking in itself. Well, yeah, Michelle, but that's wonderful progress. I mean, wonderful progress, but not wonderful to feel that at all. Except to say that that wounded inner child, that split off part of like that fragmented ego, actually. So that young you, that inner child inside of you, has been waiting for you all these years. So just know how powerful it will be to reconnect with her. And in that process, it is sort of like you take on the upload of the unresolved pain, but slowly and over time, and with the help of your therapist. And the thing is, that's what speeds up at that point, the healing process, because you develop the nurturing. This is very similar to CPTSD recovery in some ways. You have to develop that nurturing parent part to help grow, help that wounded inner child, in the case of BPD anyways, grow up, mature more. And that's definitely like the other side of the horror of it all, if I could put it that way. The really hard work getting there. And yes, the inner child will is in victim mode, absolutely. And so is the inner child of most people with CPTSD today, because this wounding and this trauma goes right back to the primal for everyone. And that's again where there's a huge overlap.